Alan Mendoza, who joins us on the line from London. Thank you for speaking to us, Alan. A little earlier on, I spoke to someone, a Palestinian MP, who told me that the Egyptian brokered ceasefire was something of a trap for Hamas in that they weren't consulted about it. They weren't involved in the negotiation of it. What do you think of that as an adjective to describe, well, that way of describing it as a trap for Hamas?
Well, it was a trap for Hamas in the sense that Hamas has clearly not achieved its objectives thus far in the conflict and wishes for it to continue. It was a trap in the sense that the Israelis had agreed to stop any activities on their side, and all that Hamas had to do was agree on the other side. But to do that would mean that they would surrender the resistance model that they have perfected in this campaign, and would also cede control within, I think, Palestinian affairs to Mahmoud Abbas again. I mean, we must remember that lots of things are going on in this battle. Although superficially it appears to be between Hamas and Israel, there's also a parallel battle between Hamas and Fatah to represent the authentic voice, if you like, of the Palestinians. That hasn't come through at the moment for Hamas as clearly as they would have hoped. And that's why they don't want to agree a ceasefire at this time. They clearly don't care about civilian casualties because they're continuing their conflict even though a ceasefire was an offer. They want to progress this for a bit longer in order to get political gains from it.
But there's clearly a bit of a trust issue, isn't there, between Hamas and the Egyptian brokers, because things have changed rather dramatically, at least in Egypt, since the last time there was a conflict of this nature.
Oh, that is absolutely correct. And you've just highlighted yet another game being played, which is the game between Egypt and Hamas as well, in terms of relations between Hamas and the Muslim Brotherhood, which the new regime in Egypt has tried very hard to drive underground. So, of course, there is a trust issue going on there. But at the same time, if a ceasefire is an offer, if, as is claimed, this is what Hamas is after in terms of not progressing a war for any purpose beyond, as they say, resistance, why wouldn't you take it? Just because Egyptians offered it, is that the reason not to? Who would they rather offer it? Qatar?
Well, I think the argument that the MP I spoke to earlier made to me was that they simply weren't consulted or involved, so they couldn't possibly agree to a set of proposals that had absolutely zero involvement in.
Well, let's look at this very carefully. The proposals seem very clear and simple in terms of what was put down. The idea they weren't involved. I don't know the background. I don't know who spoke to whom, whether there were consultations or not. I can't comment on that. What I can comment, though, is that when you receive a set of proposals, you can see for yourself if they are something you can accept or not. To reject something that is a good idea just because of who proposed it and the manner it was proposed seems to me to be a ridiculous argument.
Are you hopeful that anything can be achieved in Cairo? After all, Mahmoud Abbas is there. All the focus on all the diplomatic hope seems to be invested in what's happening there in Cairo. Do you think anything will be achieved there at all?
Well, I think a lot depends on the pressure that's applied on Hamas to stop its activity. The Israelis quite clearly are happy to cease if it's on offer. But the Hamas is not. So the question really is, can sufficient pressure be applied to Hamas to make them see sense and to end the violence? That's all they have to do. End the violence, then it goes away. But there's clearly a political reason why they're not doing it. There has to be a consummate political pressure the other way to make them see sense and to realise that this cannot continue.
All right, Alan Mendoza, the director of the Henry Jackson Society, thank you for speaking to us.